Here.
John Burdo. Bernie Dorsey.
Here.
Bruce Jones.
Here.
Lee Landzadi.
Here.
Jim Olive.
Here.
Martin Boda. Earl Walton.
Here.
Six aldermen are present, two are absent. First on the agenda tonight, I'd just like to say a few words at the chamber banquet on Saturday night. One of the aldermen got the Chamber's Award for Volunteer of the Year. I'd like Earl Walters to step forward and get this little plaque from the chamber. Thank you, Mr. Walters, for all your volunteer work.
Thank you. I'll shake hands with all my fellow.
Now for the city's Volunteer of the Month, I'd like to give this award to Reverend Bill Kearns. If Mr. Kearns would step forward. Mr. Kearns, Volunteer of the Month is awarded to Bill Kearns for outstanding volunteerism with Missions for Taylorville, for helping those in need, and for helping to make Taylorville a great place to live. Congratulations.
Thank you so much.
If Chief Cruz would step forward, swearing in of firefighter Matt Price. Julie, Chief Cruz, Mr. Price.
I want to take just a couple minutes while Julie works her way down. not my words. I want to say just a couple things about the firefighter Price. Number one, we hired a diamond in the rough. And it's a true statement to say that that dynamite does come in small packages. And that is the case. So for week one of all 7 weeks, Matt exceeded expectations. And we had such a strong treat when we went to his graduation. Matt was with 30 very, very type A young men. And he rose to the very top of the heap. And was awarded the Eskridge Award for the very highest academic performance in the academy. So we're just absolutely thrilled with that. And, so. So again, as we're here tonight, there's very few times I can speak on behalf of the entire city council and mayor. But we hope that you leave here with a lot of great gear, and which means we want some longevity, and we're just so happy to have it here. So, that being said, I think we'll go ahead and move with the report.
Do you solemnly swear that you will support the Constitution of the United States and the Constitution of the State of Illinois, and that you will faithfully discharge the duties of firefighter according to the best of your ability?
Yes, I do.
Congratulations.
If Superintendent Spiegel would come forward and a proclamation on the Drinking Water Week.
Already got a job.
Thank you. natural resource, and whereas only tap water delivers public health protection, fire protection, support for our economy, and quality of life we enjoy, and whereas any measure of successful society, low mortality rates, economic growth, and diversity, productivity, and public safety are in some way related to access to safe water, and whereas we are all stewards of the water infrastructure upon which future generations depend, and whereas each citizen of our city is called upon to help protect our source waters from pollution, to practice water conservation, and to get involved in local water issues by getting to know their water, and now therefore be it resolved that I, Bruce Berry, Mayor of the City of Taylorville, County of Christian, do hereby proclaim May 6th through 12th, 2018 as Drinking Water Week in the City of Taylorville. Congratulations.
It's just a proclamation. I get a point under that.
I better get some money for turning my camera.
Yes.
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 Earl Walters?
Yes.
Yes.
Minutes of the public hearing held in motion is approved 6-0. Minutes of the public hearing held Monday, April 16, 2018. Minutes of the regular meeting held April 16, 2018. Minutes of the Finance Committee meeting held April 18, 2018. Minutes of the Special City Council held April 23, 2018. Minutes of the Band Committee meeting held April 24, 2018.
Mayor, Alderman Boda let me know that there was an error in the Band Committee.
Right. It should say Kiwanis Park instead of Optimus Park.
And we will let them know to change that on their minutes.
Thank you for really.
You're welcome.
Minutes of the Public Facilities Committee meeting held April 26, 2018. Minutes of the Street and Sewer Committee meeting held April 26, 2018. And minutes of the Personnel Committee meeting held May 2, 2018. Motion to approve all those.
So moved, Your Honor.
Motion of Alderman Walters.
Second.
Second of Alderman Ovid. Roll call.
Bruce Jones.
Yes.
Leland Zadi.
Yes.
Jim Olive.
Yes.
Earl Walters.
Yes.
Larry Budd.
Yes.
Ernie Dorsman.
Yes.
Motion approved 6-0. Mayoral appointments to the boards and commissions. You should have one of these in your packet. And we still need a couple people for the library board, so if anybody's interested or has a member they'd like to be considered, please let me know. One thing though, there's a change on the fireman's pension fund. Per statute, if I can find that, it says the city treasurer serves as an ex officio non-voting member of the board and as custodian for the fund. So what I have done, Clerk Lilly has submitted her resignation, and in her spot, I'm going to appoint Bob Slaybaugh.
Not from clerk, just from fire.
From the fire. Not from the clerk, excuse me. And Jackie will still be a member of the Firefighter Pension Board, but she'll be a non-voting member. She'll still be the custodian for the fund. And I'm going to appoint John Blakeman to her term, and his will expire on 4/30/21. Slaybaugh's will take over for Julie, and her spot will come up at 4/30/20. And the reason I'm doing that is, as most of you know, for the last year that I've been mayor, it seems like every month we have questions on how we're going to finance the pensions. And I thought it would behoove us to get two very sound financial people on that board. It's not a demotion or anything, and I asked with Julie, and Julie thought the same thing, that she would resign from her part, and Jackie will still be part of that, but rather than just adding one financial guru, I thought I would add two, and Jackie will still be part of that board. So
don't know if we've made a motion and a second on this in the past.
We need to.
But we need to, and whoever you appoint to those boards will have to be sworn in as well.
Right.
Okay, but I didn't see a motion on there, just the mayor or appointments, but I think we need a motion and a second to accept the appointments.
Okay.
I'll make that.
First of all, Alderman Jones, second Alderman Walters, to approve the appointments of John Blakeman and Bob Slaybaugh.
Actually, the whole entire page.
Oh, approve the whole Board of Commissions, okay. Roll call.
Lee Landzadi.
Yes.
Jim Olive.
Yes.
Earl Walters.
Yes.
Larry Bud.
Yes.
Bernie Dorchenez.
Yes.
Bruce Jones.
Yes.
Motion carries 6-0. Ordinance, an ordinance to reduce the water service connection fee for non-residents.
I'd like to make that motion.
Motion Alderman Jones.
Second, Your Honor.
Second Alderman Walters. Roll call.
Jim Olive.
Yes.
Earl Walters.
Yes.
Larry Bud.
Yes.
Bernie Dorchenez.
Yes.
Bruce Jones.
Yes.
Lee Landzadi.
Yes.
Motion carries 6-0. Motion to allow Fire Chief Cruz to approve full and complete preventive maintenance on 8 sirens and 1 control panel at a cost not to exceed $7,350.
So moved.
Motion Alderman Dorchenez, second Alderman Walters.
Comment.
Comment, Alderman Walters.
Yes. It really bothers me over the years that I've seen information come across the desk as well as articles in regards to the name of our city. In this case, it says Taylorsville. It's Taylorsville, not Taylorsville. So we need to make a correction to that. Let these people know that they're dealing with Taylorsville, not Taylorsville. Thank you, Your Honor.
Roll call.
Earl Walters.
Yes.
Larry Bud.
Yes.
Bernie Dorchenez.
Yes.
Bruce Jones.
Yes.
Lee Landzadi.
Yes.
Jim Olive.
Yes.
Motion carries 6-0. Motion to forward the fiscal year 2018-2019 police budget to the Finance Committee.
Second.
Motion Alderman Dorchenez, second Alderman Bud. All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries. City Attorney update.
Gentlemen, the first thing I want to report is that the mayor has now signed a contract for his new generator, contract for the plant inspector.
Electrical.
So that's been taken care of. What I want to focus my comments on this evening is a meeting that took place last Monday, April 30th, with the mayor, Alderman Bud, with Dave Spiegel and Dick Weissman, and Don DeFreeze, the gentleman, the engineer that was doing the traffic study for documents, the IDOT on the tip, and David and Barry Bruno, who are representatives of the developer to discussion of the new stake and shake to come in the TIF District number 1, test the discussions. The mayor has asked me to kind of summarize what took place at that meeting. I invite the mayor and Alderman Bud to chip in any time if I'm saying something in error. But as I understood the meeting, and also Steve Klein was there too, your TIF District representative, the developer was hoping that the city would commit and put a letter in place that the city would put in this roadway to help this site preparation. And I passed out tonight, if you get a hold of that map that everyone's got, take a look at that real quick. And when you look at the map, what the developers are anxious to do, I don't know if for sure yet if they've actually signed a contract with the Banger family for the 4.65859 acres down there you see on the map. They came to that meeting and they was telling us that they needed to make a non-refundable deposit. They wanted some commitment from the city. I think what the mayor, Mr. Bud, and everyone there was trying to impress upon them, while the city certainly encourages development at this site and wants to do everything that we think we can do, that the city could not commit at this point in time without a full vote of the city council as to what to do. And that it couldn't be done that fast. It couldn't be a letter the very next day. And when the conversation started out, they were wanting this roadway to the north of the Bagger property, which is on the Morton property that we annexed in. There was some discussion at some point that Kim Morton was in some discussion with the mayor but possibly donated the land to the city, and we would then perhaps consider some kind of a development of that roadway. But when the annexation agreement got signed, there was no commitment on her part to do that. So we don't have anything in writing that roadway is going to be put in place, or where we, anybody can buy it and put it in place. Mr. DeFreitas is going to submit these plans to IDOT to see whether or not if IDOT will allow an interest way off of 29 to service that property, the Morton property and the Vega property, which may be the site of the stake and shake, okay? But that takes a lot of time, and the developer was very anxious to get moving with this project. So that led to the discussion as we went forward in the afternoon, that they ought to give some thought about coming up from Northern Avenue. If you look at your map there, the road that runs straight north and south, the way that's gone there, there's some discussion there that perhaps you should consider that, which would not require, I guess, an IDOT approval. It's not coming off this one, at least not, I think it would be approved by her, right?
Well, they would have to approve that so many feet, is the way I understood it.
But off the entrance way.
Yes.
So that would be a 475-foot by 60-foot length roadway. And the discussion was, developers, why don't you go back to your benefactor and consider you folks paying the cost to put that road in? And that cost was estimated, we don't have a concrete cost of it, around $300,000, as opposed to the $500,000, $700,000 for the roadway to the north. To see if you folks would do that, and then through a development agreement with the city, and based upon the revenues that your site would generate in the TIF district funds, there would be some payback to you for those costs over a period of time. Pay-as-you-go type arrangement. And that's what we were trying to get them thinking about that afternoon, which is in the best interest of the city, of course. And then we were also talking about that in order to get, apparently the water line on Northern Avenue is already there, including Mr. Spiegel, we'd have to just, it would be a service line right up there. But the sewer line, we'd have to tap in there right off of the Landmark property, a little triangle area, go across the Morton property and get to the Bangor property to provide sewer services. And I think they were asking whether the city contribute to that cost. And we don't have concrete numbers on that, but I think Richard McWise was throwing out figures around $70,000 for that cost to do that sewer and line. And I think that might include the water service too. No commitments were made. But they were asking some feedback from the city council if they would be willing to undergo that. And according to Mr. Klein, as we understand it, that with the TIF district funds, the city would be able, hopefully, get our money back for that $70,000 investment first. Then we would also ask that we get back the monies you spent to create the district. And then the excess of the money would then go back to the developer or some kind of a cap that the developer can receive. As we furthered the discussions that afternoon, then Mr. Klein was bringing up that there's also a possibility of creating a business district tax district that would allow, apparently municipalities have the power, to impose up to a 1% additional business district tax on the retailers that do business in this business district, which would include that Steak and Shake site. You've got a map there, I think, that some other materials I've had out there this evening, where Mr. Klein has given some proposal of an area for that. If the tax is put on there, it apparently doesn't apply to food drugs, and the food or drugs are anything like car titles and stuff, but that is a special tax of 1% that's only collected from those retailers that's in that district, and then the city can then use those funds how they wish, 50% split it with the developer, which I think what they're asking for, or maybe more, which would be additional funds to go back and help them pay for the development cost to put that business there. At the end of the day, what Mr. Pine was asking them is, you know, you need to file a final application to the city, get your numbers together finally. They need to know what you're going to generate in terms of sales tax revenue, what is your anticipated the real estate tax valuation and assessment once the building site is completed and ready to go in operation. And with that information, Steve then can run the numbers to project what can come back, what are the costs to develop it, and if you do what you say you're going to do in sales, how much they can expect to get back to help them make a decision about going forward. That's how I think we left that. They're anxious to get started, what we're told. They told us 3.5-4 months that if one could get started, it would take to build. But this business district, if you want to do that, in order to meet with their plans, you'll probably be asked to consider taking action at your next meeting, according to Steve Klein's memo that you've got handed out. Because it takes a 60 to 90 day process, he tells us, to put that district in place. And there's a cost to that. I think you're going to, the cost that he's estimating there, you're probably looking at about $9,300 with his office to create it, and then probably $3,750 a year annually plus cost of living index each year to maintain it. But that's something I think the mayor's going to ask you to think about, and whether or not he calls our special meeting before next meeting to get more information, it's up to him. And hopefully, Steve's waiting for information from the Bruno boys to get some more. He can't put change some numbers for us until he gets that information. So, and I think that's what we're at. There was no commitment made to them other than the commitment is we want to see you here and we want to do what we can both in the best interest of the city and to help you out to get your business started. I think that's the way the tenor we got that message that day, wasn't it? So, are there any questions thus far about what we're talking about? Yes, sir.
I'm looking at the picture here, at the description of the roadway. It looks like it's bi-directional. The fact is, for commercial development, should we emphasize we need a little bit bigger road than that? Because I'm looking at traffic situation, you know, it's going to get very critical out there. Past experience from where I've been in highways.
Which road are we looking at? Are we looking at this one north and south?
Yeah, these two roads here. It looks like two-way traffic. Right here. From New Northern Avenue,
straight
29, coming in down to that, it's two-way traffic.
Yeah, that road, when the discussions went on the 30th was, most likely you're not going to have a decision by IDOT and timely for you to start your construction, so you should think about alternative B.
But,
and alternative B was this road from north and south. That's the 457 by 60 foot wide that we told them would have to be built according to prevailing wages. It would have to be all city specs, curbs, gutters, sidewalks, and then in the pre-development agreement, if we go that route, they would then have to dedicate that to the city. That would become a city road. And for us to maintain in the future, that would be our road.
And the emphasis is on that too, because commercial traffic does weigh a lot more than the car. But the area that I'm talking about, and that is contingent to other developments. So, I mean, if you're looking at this, and past experience of Parkway Points frequently, I mean, if you've ever been up there at Christmas time trying to get through there, it's a nightmare. With Steak and Shake, Beaver, new business, we're tailored. But I'm saying about the traffic coming on Northern, it's a two-way road right there right now. The emphasis is what it's going to show in the futuristic program, so in what development out there, is a sufficient effort, 2 lanes right now, it's going to improve, I'm telling you. So, in that study, whoever's doing the drawings on this, are they looking at studies prevailing to the development of industrial or commercial development?
I can't answer that. I mean, the gentleman that was there that did this map, Mr. Frazier, I think he was doing it for the city to develop a traffic study as to what he thought, number one, would be the interest of safety, number two, is what IDOT would approve in that area. We don't know for sure what Gordon property or what we're not privy to what are the exact discussions going on there, so what they're thinking about for sure to put there. But that's the roadway they would like to see so it would accommodate future development.
Sure.
But it looks like, I think what if you folks want to go further with this, and the mayor hasn't heard back from the Bill boys yet about whether or not the benefactor is okay with this, is that at the next meeting is to, they would like to have some commitment about the sewer line. And it, you'd have all kinds of contingencies on it, of course, you know.
But it's to our advantage to ask those questions now.
Yes.
To get them answered, because of future development out there. It's very advantageous for this development to go in there.
Right.
But I think when that development goes in, commercial and industrial growth will prevail out there.
Right.
I mean, that's the next step. You know, I, the one down in Litchfield is a prime example. We're going there, a lot of cars going into that area. But there again, it's got different ways of getting in. It's a wider area. I think it's about 60 foot wide too. But high density traffic is what I'm talking about. And that'll prevail right there because people like staples. Thank you very much, sir.
Any other questions? Do you wish to add anything, Larry?
No, other than next Thursday, the 17th, we will be discussing this development.
I don't go to Christmas at Parkway Point. I do my Christmas shopping in Taylorville.
Past experiences.
I wish all you all would do all your Christmas shopping.
Past experiences, because it's one way in and one way out. It's the very best. Literally, it's happened from Braylon Castle. I didn't want one. Can you even run for the assuming responsibility? But the state did, Your Honor.
One comment. I know that all of us, all of them have lived some various things that we are obligated to do. But I think it's very apparent that I would encourage all of the aldermen to attend all of the committee meetings in the next few months because of this development and the TIF district. So that you're a part of the conversation firsthand instead of being after the vote. Thank you, Your Honor.
Thank you, Rocky.
That's a good.
Yeah.
You mentioned that that they're going to have the projected revenues, et cetera, so that we can look at those.
Right.
And an explanation of how the money will be divided up, some suggested ways the money will be divided up as far as the TIF money is concerned.
Yes.
And they'll have that by next Thursday. Is that the plan? Because if you don't have that information, I don't see how we could make
right.
any decisions or suggestions on going forward with this project.
April 30th, we left the meeting. It's a very good point. Bruner Brothers were invited to, they were going to talk to their benefactor. I forgot the guy's name.
Wilma Boltz.
They can't mention her name, so I called the benefactor. They were supposed to, the ball's in their court, in other words, to get the information to Steve Klein. I think Steve will work as quick as he can to get the information to us because there's a chart that he's given you, a timeline chart that he would, if you go forward with this business district, he's given that to you, and I pass that out to you. And that would mean we start the clock on the May 21st meeting. So that's a short window. So if the developers don't get the information to the client and he can't do his numbers, you're still in the air. And that's what we're trying to tell him at that meeting. You're asking us to make commitments when we don't know the numbers. And once we get the information, then the council can make an informed decision on what they can and not to do.
Well, maybe the TIF money hasn't been defined yet, but I'm sure that the developers, they got their ducks in a row as far as going forward with this business, what it's going to cost them. They've anticipated revenues, and they wouldn't be getting this far, I don't think.
Well, we'd like to think that, but they didn't have the numbers there that afternoon for us that.
Maybe they just didn't want to share it yet.
Well, I didn't get that impression. I think we were asking, I think Mr. Klein asked them, where do you get the numbers for what you think the real estate appraisal is going to be, assessed value for purposes of taxes, real estate taxes, when you're all said and done? And the response was, we're looking at what it is in Springfield. Well, that's apples and oranges for us. So that's why Steve said, this is the only way this works is we got to know what we think the assessment value. What's that increased assessment we get the TIF money? And what is your revenue that you're going to sell out there? So we can, if we do this business tax, what's that 1% going to amount to? And if you get a certain percentage of that, how's that going to fall in place to meet your goals and also make it worth the city's while to get paid back over the 23-year period? And there is a cap, according to Mr. Blyant, there's a cap for each district, there's a cap for what you can do, eligible cost. So your points were taken, so if we don't have the numbers on the Finance Committee, it may be a very short meeting, but but I know the mayor's anxiously waiting to hear back from the Boonville Brothers as to where the information, you know, follow-up information. And I think Mr. Klein in his memo to the mayor that I've given you a copy of says this is what I need, and we're waiting to hear on that. So I think the city is ready to move or wants to move, but it's in their court right now. All in their court.
Any other questions?
Does Mr. Spiegel or Mr. White have anything else to add to your opinion as well?
No.
Well, Mr. Spiegel always has something to say. I was waiting to get the dinner.
Really?
That's it?
Thank you. Hey, the mayor update. Spring's here. The repaving of Cherokee Street is finally finished. We have began work on Webster Street, and when that is finished, we will repave Main Cross and Lake Shore Drive in a couple hours, I think is in the plan. The city cleanup days went well. We collected over 24 dumpsters of junk. Thanks to Alderman Budd, Alderman Olive, and Alderman Walters for all their help. TIF District 1 is now finalized. We already have a talk with a proposed 15,000 square foot office building and also a state shape. We're going to try to begin to develop a business district within TIF 1 and also include the downtown area. The water plant continues to be built and is on schedule. We continue to get inquiries from solar companies, and I'm meeting with one of them regarding powering our new water plant with solar energy. This marks the one-year anniversary of my administration, and I want to personally thank the aldermen for all their hard work and direction in leading our city. Special thanks to our department heads, city clerk Julie Lilly, treasurer Jackie Nation, as well as a special thank you to George Calvert for helping me clean the city. Thanks also to Lisa Sassatelli for her tremendous help in helping me run the city. Thank you very much. Committee reports. Discussions and or motions to approve, adopt, and or deny, and or table, and or amend, and or refer to an appropriate committee in whole or in part for matters regarding the following subject matters discussed at the committee level. Finance Committee. Alderman Budd.
The first motion to come out of there was recommend the City Council to provide insurance for the 4th of July parade. I make that form of motion.
Second, Your Honor.
Motion of Alderman Budd, second Alderman Walters, with the comments by the mayor. This, I talked with the insurance company, this is already part of our insurance package. That will be no extra cost to us to provide the insurance for the 4th of July parade. So, all in favor?
Aye.
All opposed?
Aye.
Motion carries.
I get a roll call on that.
Roll call on that, okay. Roll call.
Larry Budd?
Yes.
Ernie Dorchenez?
Yes.
Bruce Jones?
Yes.
Lee Landzadi?
Yes.
Jim Olive? Earl Walters?
Yes.
Motion carries 6-0.
The next motion to recommend to the City Council to forward the following FY 2018-2019 budgets: fire, police commission, safety, cemetery, perpetual care, police pension, insurance, fire and building to the city treasurer for the retirement. Make that informed motion.
Motion of Alderman Budd.
Second
Alderman Dorchenez. Roll call.
Ernie Dorchenez?
Yes.
Bruce Jones?
Yes.
Lee Landzadi?
Yes.
Jim Olive?
Yes.
Earl Walters?
Yes.
Larry Budd?
Yes.
Motion carries 6-0.
And the last motion was to recommend the City Council to accept the trade and report as presented.
Second.
Motion of Alderman Budd, second Alderman Jones. Roll call.
Bruce Jones?
Yes.
Lee Landzadi?
Yes.
Jim Olive?
Yes.
Earl Walters?
Yes.
Larry Budd?
Yes.
Yes.
Motion carries 6-0. The band. Alderman Budd is part of the band, and so I'll read the motion. Motion to accept April 25th, 2017 Taylor Municipal Band Committee meetings with that exception where it says Optimus Park and Optimus Park.
Should say 2018, I apologize.
2018, okay. Motion by
Some
Alderman Jones, second by Alderman Dorchenez. All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries. Motion to approve the proposed fiscal year 2018-2019 band budget pending for approval from the City Council. Motion by Alderman Bud, second by Alderman Olive. All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries. Motion to accept the 2018 concert season dates.
Move.
Motion Alderman Dorcheness.
Second, Your Honor.
Second Alderman Walters. All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries. Motion to hire Jim Smith as director, Reggie Hohenstein as librarian, and Jan Phillips as manager for the 2018.
Move.
Motion by Alderman Jones.
Second.
Second Alderman Zotti. All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries. Public facilities.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Motion that came out of the public facilities was recommended to the city council to allow Phil Tolles to do the demolition and concrete work in municipal building at the cost of $26,387.50, and this is to be equally divided between all four wards. I'd like to put that in form of a motion.
Motion by Alderman Olive, second by Alderman Walters.
And Alderman Olive, may I suggest that you be including that motion, the waiver of any statutory requisite bids, since it is a season $20,000, and require that the Tolles assign the city contract for vice chief of insurance and the requisite bonds.
That's just how I was gonna write it.
I thought you did.
Comment, Alderman Dorcheness.
I've struggled with this all along, and you know that.
Yeah.
First of all, the question I have is what year are we at? Is that budgeted for the current fiscal year, which ended April 30th? Jackie?
Yes.
This is the new fiscal year's beginning now, right?
May 1st starts the new year.
May the 1st.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Has this been budgeted in last year's budget? Is it in this year's budget? What year is it?
It is in this year's budget.
Okay, so we haven't approved the budget yet. So it looks like to me this is a cart before the horse. You're asking to do work, you're asking us to vote on this tonight, and we haven't even approved the budget. As you well know, there's an issue that also that I have with buying a new generator for $130,000, emergency generator that's used once, is tested once a month. I know it's old, but it hasn't had any problems as far as I know in the monthly testing. If it hasn't had problems, it hasn't been brought to this council that I remember. The other thing that this motion includes the participation of all the wards' monies, okay? I struggle with that. And we're talking about the utility tax money, are we not? Okay, the utility tax money is the 2% tax that's imposed upon the citizens of Taylorville on the use of the natural gas that's provided. Whatever you pay for your Ameren bill, for example, 2% of that tax goes into the utility tax pool, and then that 2% pool is divided up amongst the four wards for them to decide. The aldermen in those each of the four wards, it's like Bruce Jones and I, we get to say of the 1/4 of the 2%, we pick whatever we want to do with that tax money as far as infrastructure is concerned. So with that 1/4 of that 2% money, we may pick a street to be paved, we may pick a sidewalk to be replaced, a curb, a gutter, whatever. And so that's the way it's been done in the past. Now, I don't know, I was asking council before the meeting whether that was by ordinance. I didn't have time to look it up. I don't know if that's by ordinance, but that's the way we've always done it. And so my concern here would be that this council would vote to do that, how to spend my money. And I don't think I'm representing my ward if I'm opposed for that money to be going there. And six other aldermen says, yeah, that's the way it goes. So anyway, I have a problem with that too. One of the things that Mr. Walters is aware of, and also Mr. Wiseman, is the fact that we're going to overlay West Main. We did that approximately 10 to 12 years ago. I can't remember exactly how long ago it was. Right. Denny Mackey was the street superintendent at the time. And I've gotten criticism over the years as Alderman of Ward 3, because that's where West Main Cross resides. I don't know if Mr. Jones has ever gotten any complaints, but I guess I didn't pay enough attention when they overlaid West Main 10 years ago, because what they did was, on the sides of the road, it's called curb and gutter, and I've been educated by Mr. Wiseman in the past couple of weeks, but you have the curb is the perpendicular part, and the bottom of that is called a pan, okay? So what they did was, at that time, when they stripped West Main Cross, there's bricks underneath the asphalt. So what they did was they didn't take the bricks out, they left the bricks there. They stripped West Main Cross. And when they stripped it, there were a lot of the pan, the concrete, I call it an apron, but it's about a foot of concrete that sticks out into the road. And a lot of that was broken up, okay? So what they decided to do was, concrete's very expensive, it's very expensive for the labor to put it down. And so what they did was, they just put the asphalt right over the apron, all right? So oftentimes, if you go down West Main Cross, and for the last 10 years, I've been getting complaints, not constantly, but from time to time, and you look and you'll see that some of the curb where they've overlaid the asphalt over that pan, when they overlaid it, the curb's about 1 inch tall. It's supposed to be about 4 inches tall. So it's about 1 inch tall. Other places where the pan was good and it wasn't, they overlaid that too. And so they did the same thing. So there was one person that kept coming to me early on after this was done and asked me to come down and when it rained, to come down and take the water at her. She lives on the corner. And the curb was about an inch tall. And so that the water didn't listen to that 1 inch. It just went wherever it wanted to go. All right. So the predicament that I'm in right now is that I think the right way to do it, I'm not an engineer, and I don't claim to know more than Dick Wiseman, as superintendent of the street and sewer department, and he's been in that position for years, and he's worked in that department for years. But to me, the right way to do it is to, you take a grinder and a milling machine, and you take all the asphalt that's off on the pan. And then once you get the concrete exposed, then what you do is you look at it, and you say, okay, that's broken. So you don't have to do a whole block of concrete. You would just take out the concrete that's broken and the curb. And so you would do 1 foot, 2 foot, however much is broken, you would replace that. After you're done doing all the West Main Cross like that, and I don't know what that would cost, but after you got through doing all of West Main Cross that way, then you would strip the asphalt out of the middle. And Mr. Wiseman told me they're gonna take the bricks out, and they're gonna lay 3 inches of asphalt into that brick. All right, so to me, what you would do is, you'd fix the concrete first, and if you couldn't put the street in this year, then you'd wait till next year and do it. But I think you gotta spend the money on the concrete first, and then you do the rest whenever you got the money. And we know we got the money for the street, right? We just don't know how much it would cost for the concrete. Well, by stripping it off and finding out what needs to be replaced, you can find that out. And I think that we still got some money in the till from this past year and our utility tax money that we haven't spent. And I think Bruce...
We're gonna do that West Vine Street.
We're gonna do one block, yeah, on West Vine. But aside from that, we may have some money left over, I'm not sure.
Yeah.
But anyway, so that's why I'm against doing this project at the municipal building. First of all, it's not budget. It's not past the budget yet. And number two, West Main Cross needs to be done. And it's an eyesore now where the concrete's all broken up, and I see that they've already jumped in and you've done a couple of catch basins already, and they were dynamited, right? I mean that concrete was all messed up over there, at least on the south side of the street. And so anyway, that's why I'm against it, and I don't want them to take. We need the money in our ward to be put on concrete towards on West Main Cross. And I don't want to spend my money from Ward 3 on this project. And I don't want the other six aldermen to vote against us to say, well, whether you'd like to spend that, your share of the money or not, we're gonna vote to have you spend it regardless of how you feel. That's all I got.
Any other comments? Alderman Jones?
My only comment to that, this actually started out last budget year. We're now in another budget year, but that's, that there's money on either side to cover the project. The reason why I am trying to have all four wards participate, City Hall's kind of the hub of the city. Every ward, all four wards meet up here twice a month. This is where all the decision-making is done. So I feel that it being the focal point of the city, that we should all share in the expense of keeping it looking in a well-kept manner. That's my reason for having all four wards do it, because to take it out of just the municipal budget is a good chunk of money that can be used here to do other things within the municipal building, which has kind of been, in my opinion, kind of overlooked for quite a few years. Since I came on to being a member of the council, that's been one of my focal points, is to try to get things back up to where they should be, have it looking nice. And so when people come in, especially we're trying to attract new businesses and new people into town, that we do have a nice looking facility to bring people into. So that's my reason for all four wards participating.
Alderman Jones?
Well, I agree with a lot of what my senior alderman in Ward 3 has said. I believe that this project in particular is an unnecessary project. I believe the little beautification in that area, I mean, it's an asset in the past. You come up, it's kind of a green area right in the middle of all the concrete and stuff. And I believe that, you know, whether you plant flowers in it or you just keep the grass there, whenever you walk into a lot of other places, and you can, I mean, you can use Springfield, you can use the city of Chicago, whatever, they always try and keep some type of green area in those, whether they're an artificial green area or they're plants or flowers or something like that. And I know that Alderman Walters did some plantings last year with some flowers and stuff over here on the other side of the municipal. That was 2 years ago on the municipal building. But I just believe that that little bit of green area kind of breaks up the amount of concrete and stuff that's there. Now I realize that you're walking right up to a concrete wall, but on the other side of that wall, as you go up into the municipal building, there's a green area. And I just think that this is an unnecessary cost.
I have a degree with Alderman Brochness on a project on coming in by Cherokee. It is obvious that there is a problem. I wasn't aware that the gutter pan was fully loaded with 4 inches of asphalt. And, according to what we did, transferred the jurisdiction and maintenance to the city of Taylorville. We overlaid that portion down too, though, right, Dick?
You're on the wrong place.
I'm talking about coming in on downtown. Is that the one you're walking on?
No, you're on the wrong place.
West Main. Yeah. Go down from Regents. Okay, so that needs to be done too. But that part, when we transferred the jurisdiction on that area, when we surfaced that down through there, we did the same thing, didn't we, Dick?
No. We redid the curb and gutter down on East Main.
All the way down through?
Not all the way, just where it needed it.
Okay.
But it showed gutter line when we did it. And then we paved the street.
Okay, but then when the city gave that, when the city accepted jurisdiction of maintenance in the state of Illinois, it went up to the railroad tracks?
Yes.
Okay. But I thought we did that portion in there too. But I agree with him on the part of that too. I'd like to see the area for Jim taken care of, because I think that the emphasis is to get people in and we'll look at that. But in this case, I think I have to agree with Alderman Burchett on this.
Well, there's a motion on the floor now to do the demolition concrete work at the municipal building at a cost of $26,386. $1,057.50 to be equally divided between the four wards. That was made by Alderman Olive and seconded by Alderman Walters.
With the waiver of the bidding requirements.
With the waiver of the bidding.
City contract and bonds. So let me just say, before you take your vote, in order for this motion to pass, it'll have to be unanimous vote, because the way the bidding, it takes a two-thirds vote of the Alderman. Mayor, you don't vote, so only one of you would kill this motion if you voted no, because there was no bid stated.
Was there any other bids in with this, when we done this? Was this all in the package?
I don't believe Tullis's bill is all that. We got concrete in there, and we're paying for the concrete.
That's not given to me, and I don't have it in front of me this evening.
But I believe the concrete was not bid. Concrete the city was paying for.
Right.
So you gotta take the concrete out of that bid. I don't remember how much it was.
I don't have that number with me. Is this something that could be tabled to the next meeting?
Let me ask for clarification here. I'm hearing something from Mr. Weissman. Is the proposal $26,387?
I do not know. It did not go through my office.
If Mr. Tullis's proposal is over $20,000, it was required to be bid. However, the council by two-thirds vote can waive that statutory requirement of bidding. So if you go forth the motion tonight, I'm counting the votes here, it would take a unanimous vote, because 8 divided by 2/3 of 8 is 6.
Well, if Mr. Weissman is correct, and I do have the concrete added back into his proposal, then that can be taken back out of his proposal, because the city is purchasing the concrete ourselves. It's not part of his proposal, so the numbers could possibly be wrong.
Okay, if they're wrong, they're wrong. I mean,
yeah.
I'm just going by what's on the agenda. On the agenda. So you got a motion and second, so unless there's a motion to table,
I would like to make a motion to table this.
All right.
I'll
second. Motion to table by Alderman Olive, second by Alderman Walters. Roll call on the table the public facilities motion.
Lee Landzadi?
Yes.
Jim Olive?
Yes.
Earl Walters?
Yes.
Larry Budd?
Yes.
Bernie Dorchenez?
No.
Bruce Jones?
Pass.
Motion carries 4-2. Street and Sewer Committee.
Thank you, Your Honor. We have a number of motions here. Motion to recommend the City Council to close Cherokee Street going south from Gandy Street to 2nd Street, close 1st Street and Cherokee Street from 8 a.m. to 11 a.m. on one-day services at Oak Hill Cemetery.
Motion by Alderman Walters.
Second
by Alderman Budd. All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries.
The next one we've already accomplished, but I still read the motion. Motion to recommend City Council approve the request for salvage dogs metal drive for veterans on April 27th and 28th on the corner of Market and Webster.
Motion by Alderman Walters, second by Alderman Olive. All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries.
Motion to recommend City Council to approve the request to grant special events permit for the 7th annual car cruise at O'Reilly Auto Parts on Saturday, June the 23rd. 2018 from 4 p.m. to 10 p.m. on receipt of documents. And I'd like to ask Shirley, do we have the documents yet?
No, we do not. You picked it up. We haven't brought it back yet. We have the certificate of insurance, but we don't have the actual special event form back yet.
Thank you, Shirley.
He picked it up.
Yeah, I live on Holly. And the problem is, a lot of these people that come down that car cruise come out, and I'm asking for the police to cruise the area and maintain, instead of having burnouts and all that other stuff, and coming down on Holly Street, and I mean, it looks like a drag race coming down through there. And I would entertain the thought of having a cruise, but show a little bit of respect to the people on the highway and also on the city street.
Motion by Alderman Walters, second by Alderman Budd. Is all because they get the completed documents in. All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries.
Motion to recommend the city council to approve the request and grant a special events permit for the 15th Annual American Legion Veterans Rally to be held on Saturday, July the 28th, 2018, from 10 a.m. to 12 p.m. in the 100 block of West Franklin, at Perry Case Place at Washington and Main Street.
Motion Alderman Walters.
Second.
Second Alderman Olive. All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries.
Motion to recommend the city council to approve the request and grant a special events permit for the Chamber of Commerce for two blood drives to be held on May the 18th, 2018, and August the 24th, 2018, on the southeast inside corner of the square, taking 8 parking places for the blood drive.
Motion Alderman Walters. Second by Alderman Olive. All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries.
Last motion to forward the FY 2018-2019 street sewer garbage and MFT budgets to the finance committee.
Motion Alderman Walters. Second by Alderman Robbie. All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries.
Thank you, gentlemen.
Personnel committee meeting. Alderman Vogt is not here, so I will read the motion. Motion to recommend to the city council to move forward filling the position of the school resource officer, SRO, for the school year 2018-2019, for the Tandon School District to reimburse 176 days of the base salary of the officer to be utilized for this position.
I'll second that.
Motion by Alderman Walters. Second by Alderman Olive. Questions, comments, Alderman Robbie?
I was unable to attend the personnel committee on May the 2nd. And reviewing the minutes of May 2nd, I noticed that Attorney Dorchenez wasn't there either. And what I'm going to ask is, with this, I feel neither of us had any ample opportunity to review the facts of the approval to the school resource officer at this time. With that, I'm sure that Alderman Dorchenez would second the motion, and if he's willing to do that, to table this issue, so we can go back and review that. I'm not going to get options between the other Alderman, but the facts are that I am not fully happy with the situation we're in, because it's going to be a position that's going to be very expensive. And I feel that the citizens of Taylorville will take the brunt of the officer, where we have surrounding municipalities that Stormington, Quantico, and those places. They're also sending students in here. And what I think we should do on the tuition, and I know we talked about it in those meetings, that possibly the fact is we should increase a little bit of the tuition to accommodate some of that funding. And that's my only opinion. I'm going to hold on.
Well, if I might answer, at the committee meeting, it was spelled out pretty good by Chief Heil that there would be no extra employee, there would be no extra vehicle. So, in a way, we're not increasing our costs at all. We're just reassigning an officer who's already in our schools to make him a full-time officer in the schools. So as far as you're concerned with the extra expense, there is none.
Okay, but
when that was discussed.
But in the meetings, it said Treasurer Nation had informed previously that the school was going to reimburse the city $30,000.
Right.
She was asked by the chairman Voda whether the city could afford the cost. Advice was given to the committee that she believed the amount was too low and it should be raised from the total benefit package, which includes pension costs.
Correct.
Well, there I'm talking about. Pension cost is going to cost us again.
No, well, pension cost is not going to go up. We already have the employee. So no matter what duty he does, the pension cost will not rise. So that is a falsehood. And like I said, you chose not to be at that committee meeting. I know you were out of town. You had ample time since you've been in town to discuss this, and there is a motion on the floor to vote on this. And if you have a motion to table it, that's fine, but I never heard a second on table. So I agree with the motion on the floor right now. Roll call.
So Thursday, I voiced my concerns at the personnel committee regarding the amount the schools can pay the city for the SRO, school resource officer. Again, I was advised the amount was $30,000. I also advised I believe this amount needs to be higher. Two officers in question that are interested in the position have a base salary of $53,456. This does not include their total benefit package. If the council approves the hourly rate of these two in question, the amount is $25.70 at 1,408 hours, which is 176 days, which totals $36,185.60. I also asked the question if they considered the total benefit package, and they did not. If the total benefit package was considered, my calculation is this. And you have a copy of the sheet I passed out earlier to everybody. Officer one has family insurance, and their total benefit package is $101,156. If you take that amount, divide that by 2,080 hours, which is 1 year of what they work, is $48.63 an hour. Take 4863 times 1,408 hours, that amount is $68,471.04. Officer two has employee and children insurance, and their total benefit package is $90,158. If you take that amount, divided by the 2080 hours, you get $43.35 an hour. Take that times 1,408 hours, and that total is $61,036.80. As city treasurer, it is in my opinion, especially with the consistent decline in revenues that we receive by the city, that city tax dollars should not be utilized for the time our officer is dedicated to this terrible school district. That's why I think the amount should be higher than
$36,185.60.
Thank you.
Jones,
you got any questions?
Yeah, I was hoping that Dr. Firstnow would be here tonight to hear any other discussion that was going on.
He was at the committee meeting.
Yeah, I know he was at the committee meeting. And I had a discussion with him following that committee meeting, because I wasn't able to be at that meeting, I was out of town. But I talked with him, and he said, you know, we're talking about an hourly rate, and he said, you know, if that rises, you know, with contracts and stuff like that, that they would still be paying the hourly rate, whatever that is. I believe that Treasure Nation brings up a good point as far as, you know, the cost and stuff like that, and that doesn't include any pension calculation. And I had a conversation with Treasure Nation about the facts and figures that she had, and then we started talking about the pension cost. The pension cost is what it is, but if the school district is going to pay for that officer, looking at that, you know, it's city tax dollars and the school's tax dollars. It's all tax dollars, no matter where it comes from. But, you know, I believe that the rate, you know, even the hourly rate, if we're not going to bring another employee on and we're already absorbing those costs, I believe that I could probably support with just the hourly rate without the added cost. The thing is, we have a new officer that is slated to start with Tidwell City, based upon one of our officers leaving, and that officer hasn't left yet. So when we get to the point where this guy is supposed to be gone and the new officer is supposed to start, now we're going to have the other officer on board. So we're going to have added costs there. And we you know, I don't know if we need to hold off on hiring that officer until we get that officer's resignation in their barn. And I realize that there's an academy that's gonna be starting in May, and I hate to put that academy off, but I don't think that we can take on the added cost of another employee when this other employee doesn't even know if they're gonna be leaving or not. So if we do that, and then we start adding the school resource officer, which won't start for another 4 months, or 3 months, 3 months or 4 months, however long that vacation time is, the rest of the school year. But somebody's gotta get trained to do that job. So while that officer is being trained, and I don't know how long that training is going to take, you're gonna be missing an officer, you're gonna have an officer that could possibly still be here, plus one additional officer, and then you're gonna have to have all three of those people there. It's gonna cause a little bit of overtime, and Chief Heil's not here either to talk about any of these scenarios, which, you know, so I think you've got two people there that need to be part of this conversation, and I don't want to postpone the vote, but I think that with the increased cost and not having Dr. Furstenow's look his ideas upon that amount, and I don't have any problem taking a vote on resourcing this officer, but and they're gonna for the 176 days. But when, you know, we're going to have to come to some agreement on the base salary and the benefits if we end up having to hire an extra person. If we're hiring an extra person, which you're saying that we're not, Chief Heil is saying that we're not,
right.
I don't have a problem supporting that. But we're looking at having another employee join us in 2 weeks. And we still have another officer that hasn't left yet.
And that employee was approved by the council a couple months ago before really this SRO officer was basically discussed.
I agree.
And when that other officer was approved, we were in the same situation. I think one of y'all needed to raise that. In the past, we had always waited for a letter of resignation or retirement
mm-hmm.
before we hired her, and it was stated in committee that we needed, that they were 99% sure that this officer was leaving.
Mm-hmm.
And I still think, and correct me if I'm wrong, Assistant Chief Childers, but we are under the assumption that this officer is leaving to go either to Chatham or to the state police.
That's correct.
That's
he still
correct.
Has the two
so,
options.
Well, we're time sensitive because we need to get this resource officer properly trained
mm-hmm.
to be able to start. And, you know, I know what you bring up, it makes sense, but it's like apples and oranges. We've already approved the new officer. So if we get stuck, we get stuck. Now I guess, even though we approved him, we went through training, we could go back and not hire him and not let him start. I don't think that's ever been done, but I think that is a possibility. So, in other words, if we don't want to go to the extra expense, if this first officer does not go elsewhere, does not put in his resignation, we could, as a council, decide not to let this guy start, even though he's properly trained.
But no, they're not properly trained yet. They haven't been through the academy.
Well,
their first day here is going to be at the academy.
Correct.
Correct.
But we've already approved that.
Correct. Yes, we have. But that's all based upon the resignation of that officer. So that's what I'm saying. I want to get this school resource officer trained. I want to support this as it stands, but I don't want to hire that new officer until that, because it's going to add more cost to what we have.
That would be another decision.
I've got a comment.
All right.
I've supported the SRO from the beginning. But tonight I'm struggling with the fact that I think this is a very important decision to be made and voted on. We got two aldermen missing at the city council meeting, which is odd, unusual. In the meeting, the vote was 2-1.
Correct.
So it wasn't unanimous. I'm on the committee. I couldn't attend that meeting that night.
so with the vote 2-1 and two aldermen missing, what I would suggest we do is, and I'm going to make a motion to table it. I'd like to see it tabled, and if we have to have a special city council meeting, let's do that. So I'll make a motion to table.
Lee made the motion to table it earlier. Are you going to second his motion?
I'll second the motion. I didn't know he made the motion.
One more comment. Can I agree with that?
No comments.
All right, motion to table this, made by Alderman Lozada, second by Alderman Dorcheness. A yes vote would table it, a no vote would not table it. I'm going to vote on it. And, no comment. Roll call.
Jim Olive.
No.
Earl Walters.
No.
Larry Bud.
Yes.
Ernie Dorcheness. Bruce Jones.
Yes.
Lee Landzadi.
Yes.
Motion is tabled, 4-2.
And Mr. Mayor, I believe that Mr. Dorcheness's comment about having a special city council meeting, whether that's next Monday when everyone will be here or not, you know, I believe that having Chief Heil and Dr. Person out at that meeting, so the discussion is fully apprised by both sides, would help.
And if that's the only thing on the agenda, it wouldn't take very long.
Yeah.
All right. Motion to approve and or ratify the payment of bills, Alderman Bud.
I'll make that motion with a comment. Bills total to $835,807.60.
Second.
Motion Alderman Bud, second Alderman Jones.
Okay, insurance, $110,171.77. Illinois Public Risk, workers' comp for June, $24,487. Total for the insurance, $134,658.77. Electric, $21,063.46. Telephone, $1,129.92. Garbage, $6,352.06. VR, Ace, Urban, Bronze, and Walmart, $3,253.89. Office supplies, $1,220.84. Tap Business Systems for new printer and supplies, $1,925.64. Peter Tech, $2,687.98. Altor for $24,842.99. IMCO for pipe and supplies, $1,073. Phil Tolis, $16,121.10. Ronald Emerson for equipment repairs, $1,500. Nikes floor covering for carpet, $1,085. Gall's equipment and uniforms for police and fire, $1,632.11. United Capital Funding for temporary help, $7,748.74. Jackson Lewis for labor attorney, $9,375.70. Meyer Austin Romano, $6,664. Christian County Treasurer for Animal Control, $4,800. IMT for bond insurance for the mayor and for the clerk, $1,050. The Van, Jan Phillips for equipment, $1,049. Police Department, Lily Signs, $1,209.67. Ray O'Haron for uniforms and equipment, $2,836.61. Nelson Systems for a service agreement, $3,921.49. People's Bank and Trust for radio equipment, payment 4 of 10, $12,986.10. Fire Department, City of Charleston for ambulance billing, 79 claims, $1,975. Two Brothers Tuck Pointing, $2,950. Southwestern Illinois College, PTI tuition for arson, $4,566. Econolights, lights and fixtures, $3,135.50. People's Bank and Trust, radio equipment, payment 4 of 10, $8,389.65. Street Department, paint and limestone, $6,978.77. Alpha Omega for repair of the stump grinder, $1,560. J.H. Broughton for premix, $1,484.97. DVI, $9,063. U.S. Bank for truck payment, 1 of 3, $40,647.28. Water Department, Benton and Associates, $1,510.25. Hatch Company for maintenance agreement, $1,215. Midwest Meter for meters and supplies, $8,329.98. chemicals, $22,287.36. Sperling Title for water easements, $1,200. Sewer Department, J.F. Cody for supplies, $2,066. Green and Bradford, Phase 5, 30, the final, $5,963.80. Petersburg Plumbing, 30-inch final, $345,839.65. Airport, Crawford, Murphy, and Tilly. This is a pass-through from the overlay, our part, $39,464.23. Aviation Insurance, $2,900. Lake Department, Jenner Ag for the Kubota and some inspections, $12,544.20. Noblet Lawn Care for tree removal, $1,625. Lake Lot and Campground Refunds, $3,600, and these total $799,483.71.
Roll call.
Earl Walters.
Yes.
Larry Bud.
Yes.
Ernie Dorchenez.
Yes.
Bruce Jones.
Yes.
Lee Landzadi.
Yes.
Jim Oz.
Yes.
Motion carries 6-0. First subparagraph G of 5 ILCS 120:2.06. This portion of the city council meeting deserves any person wishing to address the council on any relevant subject matter concerning the city. The Illinois Open Meeting Act 5 ILCS 120:1 mandates no action shall be taken on subject matters not listed on the agenda, but the council may direct staff to address the topic or refer the subject matter to a future council and or committee meeting. If anyone wishes to address the council, please provide your name and address, limit your comments or presentation to 3 minutes, and avoid repetitious comments. Anyone out there in the audience like to address the council?
Yes, Mr. Mayor. Good evening. My name is Teresa Haley. I am the Illinois State President for the NAACP, also the Springfield Branch President of the NAACP. So we are here tonight out of concern. We truly believe in our heart that injustice anywhere is injustice everywhere and for everyone. We have received several complaints, telephone calls, meetings, regarding concerns here in Taylorville. We have lots of family and friends that live here in Taylorville, that shop here in Taylorville. My girlfriend and I, when we were shopping for furniture a few years ago, we still come over here and support Taylorville, and we want you, Mr. Mayor and City Council members, to continue to come over to Springfield to support and shop there as well. Our complaints tonight are against your superintendent of streets and sewers. There has been continual use of the N-word, which we consider to be disrespectful. We are living in a climate and a time where people are changing, but the world still remains the same. There are concerns that the N-word is being used at the break room table, and when it is addressed, it is not handled in an appropriate manner. It has gotten so much out of hand that we're here tonight before it appears on Facebook and other forms of social media. We have heard comments like, shine like an N-A-S-S, kill in lovers, relatives. We live in a multicultural society, and I have family and friends who have been in foster care here in Taylorville, Illinois. We want to make sure that all families, all children, all employees are treated fairly and equally without discrimination. Employees have been told that they work like an N-word. They have also been told to N-rig a truck on a van when there's problems and it can't be repaired in other manners. Oftentimes, homophobic comments are made, such as calling people queers, faggots, retarded. In the general public, which is disrespectful to all of us here tonight in this room. We have ran into customers who've called over to Springfield to our answering service, and our answering service staff is appalled. The NAACP is not just about black folks, sir. It's about all folks working and living together and being respectful of one another. We bring these concerns tonight because we want everybody to be treated with respect and with dignity. And as a member of a union, a lot of our union employees have called in from Taylorville, simply saying if they complain, they are retaliated against. This behavior has to stop. As you notice, I talked about the concerns, but I did not mention a person's name. In response to this, we have gone, and customers and employees have gone to human rights, your social service, your human services department, you as the current mayor and past mayor, and nothing has been done about it. So we're here tonight to make sure that these issues and concerns are heard, recorded, and addressed.
Thank you for that.
Thank you.
I might say nobody has ever came to me and addressed any issue that was brought up at one of the meetings, and I did not take it that it was true. As far as the superintendent, as far as my personal experience with him, I've never heard him use a derogatory N-word, homo, whatever words that you describe. I've never personally heard him say that. If I do, he will be dealt with. I can give you my word. But I've never had one union employee or anybody else mention that is going on at the street department.
Okay, well, we have it in writing. We'd be willing to share those with you. We've also asked those employees to go to the Department of Human Rights and EEO, okay. But we wanted to come tonight and make the full city council aware of our concerns,
right.
As it relates to Taylorville.
And that is a concern for everyone up here. I'm sure it is. So if you can give me, like I said, what you've had in writing, I will be more than happy to look at it and discuss it. But like I said, personally, I've never heard our street superintendent use a derogatory word. Now, I'm not around him very much, but mm-hmm. in the meetings that I've had, I've never had one union member mention it to me. I've never had our human resource manager mention that she's ever received that complaint. And so, as far as not saying that you're not telling us the truth, because I'm sure you are, but as far, you know, I have not heard that.
Please just consider sexual harassment. It does not have to be sexual,
right.
in nature.
Right.
Creating a hostile work environment for all employees mm-hmm. is a concern,
right.
and we're bringing that issue to you tonight.
Right. Thank you.
Thank you.
Motion for adjournment.
So moved.
Motion by Alderman Dorchin.
Second.
Second by Alderman Walters. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Council meeting is adjourned.
Thank you, Matt.